Now, Blend for Web's been around for a while, but I did a video on installing the Blend for Web add-on to Blender some time ago, but there's been a few changes, and since I'm doing this series on how to run a set of drone images through an open source tool chain and getting it all the way through to a 3D model and an HTML file, I'm doing a series of videos that show each step along the way, and one of those steps is installing Blend for Web. So we're going to go ahead and redo that video since it's been a while and there have been some changes. So go ahead and take a look. It's not that complicated. And as part of this, I'll show you how to, you know, import an OBJ file that's been produced by OpenDroneMap, and then we will export it into an HTML file that's easy to share with anyone with a browser. All right. Long ago, I did a video on how to install Blend for Web, which is an add-on for HTML export of your models. But in addition to that, it's a full SDK capable of doing, full-on video games that play in the browser. So we're going to install that add-on in Blender. And so what you'll do is go to blendforweb.com/English/downloads. And while you're here, go ahead and go to Made With. And you can see what the Blend for Web add-on is capable. It's really astounding. The team behind this has put a lot of work into it, and they've done really well. So you can develop fully functional web apps that run in 3D, and it turns Blender into an SDK for developing 3D web applications. And so here's some of the projects. This one was developed by NASA. This is a 3D experience where you can, play with the rover on Mars. And go ahead and look through some of these. They're really astounding. And all of these play out in the browser, so you can experience these right on your computer. So do take a look at that. But back to the download page. So they have a community edition that's free. The CE is a community edition, and that's going to do everything you want for the most part. And then if you want to get into some heavy development, go ahead and purchase the pro version. After you see what it can do, you might realize it's worth it. There's a lot of assets and materials that come with the pro version. I bought it some time ago, and it's definitely worth it. So take a look at that. But go ahead and download your SDK, and it's going to be a zip file. And then what you'll do is unzip that download into a download location, probably like on your C drive, and you'll want to leave it wherever you put it, because eventually if you move it, then Blender won't be able to find it. So during the installation process, we're going to show Blender where it's at. Now, I do something a little bit unusual. I have it actually on an external drive because I move my SDK from PC to PC, and the whole environment goes with me. So actually, it will go from PC to Mac to Linux and run just fine on all those. And so Blender runs on all those too. So in order to get that up and running, so we'll go to File, User Preferences, and we'll go to System. Oh no, File, I mean, here we go. And then we're going to go to Scripts. And what we're going to do is just point this file to that Blend for Web folder that we extracted it to. And so when you extract that, you're going to make sure you don't have, sometimes when you unzip a folder, you end up with a folder within a folder. So basically, you want your Blend for Web, and it's probably going to say Blend for Web CE and the edition number. Make sure you open that folder and all your files that are in there. You don't want to open that folder and have another folder named Blend for Web. So go ahead and direct it to that folder, hit Save User Settings, and then what you're going to want to do is close, I already have it installed on here, but you'll want to close Blender and reopen it to so Blender now knows where that file is, and then go to User Preferences again, and we're going to activate the add-on. So it's going to have, this is a recent change, it's going to have its own heading right over here on the left-hand side of the Add-ons tab of your User Preferences. So go ahead and select Blend for Web, and go ahead and hit this check mark. And it's always been that when you hit it, you just click it one time, just give it a minute to pause, because sometimes you'll sit there and keep clicking it and you'll get confused. So just go ahead and click that to activate that, and give it a minute until you see it's checked and you're good to go. And then you'll hit Save User Settings again. And at this point, you'll have a Blend for Web render engine. And the way that works is each of these render engines is kind of like a separate dimension of Blender. they share some things and some things they don't. So be aware of that. Some things, like if you're doing, in a previous video I did a bake of this, so I baked a number of textures into just one texture on this, and that would be, that bake was is a blend, a blender render function, and if you watch that video, I'll link to it, you'll see how that works. But since we're going to export this and take a look at it in an HTML file, we're going to be in Blend for Web. So simply put, once you're installed and up and running, you just go to File, Export, and you're going to have this JSON and HTML format. So if you're doing more of a fully functional web app, you know, that they have a full scripting API capable of doing, you know, limitless things, really, you know. Or you can just export into a self-contained HTML file that has everything all in one file, and that's what we're going to do. So we're going to export to our directory that we have everything else saved in here that we've been working on in other projects, and it's going to be rock-4blend.html. So we'll just hit export, and it's going to wrap that all up into an HTML file. So here is the file we just created. So let's go ahead and open that up and have a look. So this is a one-step export. You know, once you've got the SDK and or the well, it is an SDK, but once you have this add-on installed in Blender, it's a one-step export. You basically just hit File, Export to HTML. Okay, so what we're going to do is adjust the clipping, since this is actually a huge model. So it's clipping away in the distance, and we're going to give it a nice sky too. So let's do that. Let's bring up Blender, and so what we're going to do is make sure we're in the Blend for Web tab. We're going to select our camera. And when we select the camera, we see we have this new camera panel right here. And let's go change a few things. So first of all, we're going to do our clipping, and let's just give us a lot of room there, because we don't really need a limit on that, because we don't have anything far away that we're trying to occlude. And then let's go down to display limits in the viewport. And so that's the limits of our camera zooming in and out. And so we're going to go ahead and increase that too. Let's go ahead and just increase it to 200, because there again, well, 100 maybe, 150. That's pretty huge. So that's pretty good. That gives us all the room we need. And then we're going to limit vertical rotation, just so we don't rotate right over the top. Because I want to be able to see all angles, but we don't need to go over the top and, you know, get confused. So we'll do that. And then I'm going to go to the world panel and hit Render Sky, and then give us a sky that's not ugly. Let's give us something kind of bluish and sky-like. Maybe a little sort of darker blue, like that. And then over here in the view panel, we can come down, if we want to see it, come down to display. I call this the view panel, it's something else anyway. We'll just come down to display and just hit world background. That way we can see what it's going to look like while we're in editing our model here. And we'll go ahead and hit File, Export, HTML, and then Export. And there we have it. So let's go ahead and bring up our file again. So the address is going to be the same, so at this point we can just refresh and it will reload that HTML file. And so there you have it. So it put our camera, boy, our limits are still there. But still you can see how that works, but we can still change some things. So there is our model, our 3D model. So this was scanned with a cell phone, and then we ran it through the Open Drone Map software. We do drone mapping, but drone mapping is essentially 3D scanning. So in a situation like this, you're not going to be getting the geo tagging data. So the difference between 3D scanning and drone mapping is that a drone map is just a 3D model that has geotagging data to apply it to a place on Earth, whereas 3D modeling just makes a model with no fixed location on the planet. And so I did this with a cell phone about 18 inches away from the rock, and I just took sort of a dome pattern where I took one picture in the middle and then domed down to sort of close to the ground on 8 different angles. I think I ended up with something like 57 pictures or 70 pictures or something like that. But anyway, so let's while we're here, let's make a couple more adjustments just so we can tweak that a little bit. So let's bring up Blender. I'm going to go ahead and increase our max to 250. There's no reason to have a limit on a model like this. And then what we're also going to do is we're going to set our, as it happens now, the camera starts off right there, kind of with that rock right in your face. So first I'm going to hit 7, and we'll grab, and we'll put it back up here, and then I'll hit 1 on the number pad, and we'll grab and put it up here. And it's going to be looking at that spot anyway. So let's go ahead and see what that looks like. So File, Export, HTML. So with Blend for Web, there's a lot more to it, so do explore that. At this point, I just want to introduce you to it. If you're doing drone maps, this works for exporting terrain as well as 3D scanned objects into an HTML file to make sharing a lot easier. So let's go ahead and refresh this. So there it started our camera a little further away, and you can make some adjustments and choose where the camera's looking. For example, I might adjust it so you end up with a view kind of like that. So when it first comes, it can look like that. And this is sort of the default player. If you're doing just a straight export to HTML, you kind of end up with this default player, but if you're doing a more involved application, you can end up with everything completely custom. But you do have some options here. You can get into WebVR. You can look at this with a Google Cardboard or some of the virtual reality platforms. And we're going to go ahead and put an automatic rotation on it. Okay, so there's probably going to be corrections and updates because Open Drone Map is under heavy development. So if I have any changes, I'll put them down below. And so also do check out Blend for Web as well. There's a lot of potential there if you're into developing 3D applications for the web. So here's Blender. We're gonna delete the original cube. We're gonna go File, Import, OBJ. We're gonna go to that ODM texturing file. And we're going to grab that OBJ file right there. And so here we are. Here's the scan that we did. It's 90 degrees at a 90 degree angle from horizontal. So first of all, we'll go ahead and set that. We'll just go R90. And then we're going to change the right now the origin point is fairly a fair distance from the model, so we'll go Object Transform Origin to Center of Mass. That works. And let's take a actually we should show you the texture on this. So right now it's set to solid view. Let's move it to material. So there's material, and you can see we have a very little bit of light from that light source we have right there. If I had only one material on this object, I would just set it to shadeless. But since we have, you know, a dozen materials on there, we're going to go to the world view and select environmental lighting. And so here you can see our 3D scan, and there's my foot even made its way into there. So at a more oblique angle, you start picking up sort of peripheral trash. So first off, we're going to go ahead and do some editing to get rid of that. So I'm going to hit 5 to go into orthographic view. What that means is that there's no shrinking with distance. Everything lines up perfectly. So we're going to hit the 7 on the number pad to look at it directly from above. We'll tab into edit mode. A to select and deselect everything. So I'm going to select this little box here, which means we select pixels or vertices that are behind each other. So I'm going to hit B to select. And so what we're going to do is go ahead and crop the whole thing. I just hit B, and every time I hit B it selects another group, and hit X to delete, and select vertices, and we're going to tab, and let's go ahead and make it a little bit kind of square. Let's go hit B, B, that's pretty good. Let's hit 5 to go out of orthographic, and I'm going to go ahead and hit the N key. You can also do that by hitting this little thing here. And I'm going to set the location manually at 0, 0, 0.